charming Spanish-style three-story apartment buildings and private homes with white stucco walls and sloping orange-fluted roofs border the fairways and greens of beautifully maintained and landscaped golf courses. The land, flat with slightly rolling hills, is offset by lush tropical plants and palm trees. There are artificial lakes, fountains of arching water lit by spotlights at night, ponds spanned by narrow wooden bridges, swimming pools with striped umbrellas, chaise lounges and cabanas, a clubhouse with a locker room, a sports shop, offices for the golf pros, and a garage for the motorized canopied golf carts. The main building houses the administrative offices, a dining room that serves breakfast, lunch, and dinner, club rooms for bridge, mahjong, and canasta, and a ballroom. There's a cross gate with caution stripes at the entrance of the fountains. You slip a coded card into a metal box, the gate lifts automatically, and you drive through. And here you can see a car driving through the open gate. Private security force of off-duty moonlighting police officers cruises the streets in patrol cars. The development is also surrounded by a chain-link fence topped with barbed wire and a moat-like canal which is covered with a film of scum and floating debris and sometimes stinks like a sewer and from which alligators occasionally groggily stagger up the embankment. News of sightings of alligators spread through the colony like wildfire, and are considered second in importance only to the accidents, illnesses, or deaths of neighbors, which are discussed obsessively in a kind of reverential hushed tone by everybody. Most of the women try to look much younger than they really are. Once I tried to find my mother at a women's luncheon. I stood in the doorway of the ballroom looking in at hundreds of women in their 60s and 70s with dark tans, blonde hair, fleshy arms, sagging folds of skin under their chins, wearing bright, colorful outfits and lots of jewelry. Everyone looked exactly like my mother. It was like a bad dream in which she'd been duplicated hundreds of times. She was sitting at every table, talking animatedly with clones of herself, and I didn't know which one was the real one. And I made my way from table to table, trying to recognize her by a piece of clothing, a familiar gesture, but I couldn't find her. Then I stood outside the ladies' room calling her name, but no answer. And I checked the phone booths down the hall, but they were empty. And for a moment, I was afraid I'd never see her again. That a woman who strongly resembled my mother would show up at our door after the luncheon. But I'd know in my heart she was a fraud. Like one of those invaders from outer space in science fiction films who take over the bodies of humans. Finally, I collared the chairwoman of the luncheon committee. She looked at a list of names and gave me the number of my mother's table. And only then was I able to find her. And there she was. Like a miracle. And here's Freddy, my adoptive father, walking stoop forward in the aisle of a drugstore, carrying discount coupons to purchase a cologne and a shampoo. You can see the shine in his pants. Mom says she can comb her hair in the reflection. She's always complaining that he looks like an eyesore in his old threadbare clothes. Now, here he's reaching for Brute, one of the items. He looks sad, touching, a victim of his early history, of a childhood spent in poverty, of living in a home where there was constant squabbling over money, of going out on the road and barely making a living during the Depression as a traveling salesman, driving around the country, selling dental equipment. When we get to Randy's Ribs, a chicken and rib place near the fountains. He brings along another coupon he cut out of this morning's newspaper, which entitles us to a free onion loaf, and here you can see him hand it to the waitress. Can you see the color in my cheeks? That odd expression on my face? I feel it's demeaning, degrading. While on the other hand, I tell myself, well, why not save money if you can? What's wrong with that? And now he's asking if he can get a free dessert too. Isn't that also part of the deal? And you can see the waitress shaking her head, saying, no. Then he puts on his glasses, examines the check, and asks the waitress if the baby back ribs are accurately priced at $10.95. He thinks it's a little expensive for what he got. And if you look closely, you can see annoyance in the waitress's face. But she's trying her best to be patient with him. When we get up to go, he leaves her a $3.50 tip on a $26 check, which comes out to less than 15%. And I, the last one to leave, slip another dollar on the table. I don't want him to see me do it. And I do it all the time when Freddy takes me out to dinner. The man has more money than he'll ever need. He's in his late 70s, and I can't understand, although I do understand, why he can't be more generous. Mom says he's penny smart, pound foolish. When he gets his Social Security check, he sometimes waits over 2 weeks to deposit it in his interest-bearing checking account. And he has over $50,000 in a bank savings account, rather than in a higher interest yielding CD or in a money market fund. But he waits until Thursday to go shopping because that's the day the discount coupons appear in the papers. And he spends an hour going through the ads, cutting them out. And when she points out his inconsistency, he gets angry and tells her sharply that one thing has nothing to do with the other. Not to mention the fact, she adds, that he consistently buys the cheapest, lowest quality products on the shelves, claiming that everything is the same anyway. Then she tells me about the time they were online at the supermarket, and she went off to find one more item. And when she returned, he'd already gone through and paid. So in order to avoid standing online again, she went directly to the manager's office. The item was about 90 cents, and when she met Freddy, who was waiting for her at the other side of the checkout counter, he was disappointed she hadn't gotten stamps. And she was furious with him. You don't live on Morris Avenue anymore, she hissed at him, referring to the neighborhood in the Bronx where he grew up. Well, that's what it's like living with a man who hates to part with money, she says. His books of stamps and coupon collecting are driving her crazy. And then she tells me how he scrapes the leftover food out of the cat's dish when she's finished her dinner and puts it back in the can to serve her the next morning. But when she curls up on a dinette chair, another has to be brought into the room so that they can both sit down because he doesn't want to disturb her. Can you believe this? She asks me. Now, she's worried that this obsessive behavior concerning money is beginning to rub off on her. She just mailed a $5,000 gift check to her nephew Alan, writing him a short note on their old stationery with their old address scratched out and their new one written in hand, rather than begin using their new stationery with the correct address, because she didn't want to be wasteful. You see, she says, it's contagious. Then she tells me about their trip to Switzerland, a trip he opposed for months before finally giving in to her, and which he booked on the cheapest charter flight he could find, a plane load full of noisy, raucous students. By the time the plane landed in Zurich, she had a migraine. Then, instead of taking a cab directly to the hotel, he insisted they go by train. But on the way down to the tracks, one of the carts with their bags on it got caught in the bottom of the escalator, and Freddy fell on top of it and Mom, with her cart of bags, came down on top of him. And they were sprawled there on top of each other in a pile of suitcases, while more and more people riding on the escalator came down on top of them, like products on a conveyor belt. And there was a huge pileup and no way to stop it. And she bruised her arm and Freddy cut his shin, and the blood stained his slacks. She says now that she'll never fly on a charter again. And next time, if there is a next time, they'll take a cab. Mom likes her soup boiling hot. So when she brings the steaming bowls to the table, as you can see here, you have to wait a few minutes before you start eating, because you don't want to burn your tongue and ruin the rest of your meal. So you try and be patient. You make light conversation, keep your mind occupied. Try not to let the aroma overwhelm your better judgment. But Freddy can't wait, and here he is plunging in, sucking air into his mouth along with the soup on the spoon in order to cool it. A kind of wet, slurping sound. Then, finally, unable to hold out any longer, I begin skimming the soup off the top with a spoon. I have a theory, I don't know if this is true, that human cheek and throat tissue thins as you grow older, because my parents make a tremendous racket when they eat. I can hear crackers being shattered between their teeth, the crunching of crisp vegetables and salads, and loud gulping and gurgling whenever they swallow. And listening to it, my face gets hot, sweat begins to form on my brow, drops of perspiration run down my sides. Here you can see me take another sip of my vodka tonic to calm myself. And I turn on Freddy's portable radio, which sits on the sideboard next to the dinner table. I tune it to a classical music station to drown out the sounds of their chewing and swallowing. And by now you can see a drop of Roquefort salad dressing on my mother's cheek and a kernel of rice stuck to the grease on Freddy's chin. And this always happens. The areas around their mouths as the meal continues become speckled with more and more debris. And I've become so sensitive to this, their complete lack of awareness of their appearance at mealtimes, that I've become obsessive about wiping my own mouth. Whenever I go out to eat with friends or with people I meet at work, I worry that food is collecting around my lips without my knowing it. And I compulsively wipe my mouth after each forkful. Now Mom is serving me a second helping of chicken and carrots, and she asks Freddy if he wants another portion. He says, not yet. She says, come on, have something. I'm not ready, Freddy says. But I'm serving now, she argues, her voice getting sharper. I'll serve myself, he answers. You're too sloppy, she says. You can't do it without making a mess. I hate her at that moment. When Freddy goes into the kitchen for some more soda, I say to her, you shouldn't be so hard on him. You're right, she says. I'm too impatient. I should try to control myself. At the end of the meal, Mom clears the table herself. Freddy and I are not permitted to help because Mom says the kitchen gets too crowded. So we sit there like obedient children. Then she brings us cups of coffee. Freddy takes a sip, and here you can see him swishing it around in his mouth, sucking it in and out between his teeth, then swallowing. His purpose is to clear away any loose particles of food. Now they both take out toothpicks and begin to probe, gouge, prod, and pick their teeth. I look out the window at a tree in the sky beyond. It takes me away from this room and these two old people whom I love, but who sometimes drive me crazy. And by looking out, I project myself into another reality and partially escape from this one. Now they're arguing about washing the dishes. Freddy says he'll do them. Mom says she'll do them. I'm faster than you are. I've been doing it for longer, Mom says, adding that Freddy works so slowly it drives her nuts, and that he's a bumbler. And he says, his voice getting lower, I am not a bumbler. You struggle, she says. I don't struggle, he says. I'm slower. You're faster. So what? Finally, Freddy does the dishes, while Mom complains to me in the living room. He's so disorganized. When he gets dressed in the morning, he walks back and forth, in and out of the bathroom 100 times, getting things. And whenever they go out for the evening, and they're getting into the car in the garage, he always has to go back into the house for something he's forgotten. His glasses, or his wallet, or a bottle of wine. She wishes he'd read more, put his mind to some use instead of watching Home Improvement and Taxi and other crap on television. She wishes he wouldn't take cans of cat food out of the refrigerator and leave them on the counter all night so the food won't be too cold in the morning. Can that be good for the cat? The food isn't as fresh. She argues with Freddy about it, but he stubbornly continues to do it. In fact, every one of her suggestions he says no to automatically. And it drives her crazy. Why won't he listen to her? Maybe she has some good ideas. And he walks around their house nude, and sometimes when she's sitting on the edge of the bed, he'll stop in front of her and talk to her with his thing in her face. And she wishes he'd wear shorts or a robe. And often he can't follow the conversation when they're with friends. And he embarrasses her in public by asking gas station attendants, department store clerks, waitresses, checkout counter cashiers, vendors, and policemen, all sorts of pointless questions. He needs to fill his mind with useless information, she says. And here, in this shot, we're waiting for a table in a Chinese restaurant. And he's asking the cashier, who's busily tallying up checks, what's good here? Is there something better than the Mugu Gai Pan? And now, at the end of the meal, you can see him pop a fortune cookie into his mouth, having forgotten to remove the fortune, and begin chewing on it. And here he's spitting out the pieces of the cookie with the paper onto his plate. I can't stop myself from laughing. But Mom just sits there shaking her head, looking at the ceiling.
Substance,
no mass. It's the irredeemable coupon, the final handshake, the least welcome visitor, the cruelest joke of all. It can be fastidious or sloppy, prissy or a mess. It can sneak up on you or reserve its place in advance. It is forever a great consolation and a consolation prize. It's the last thing you'll ever do. It's a hollow laugh, like crow's feet over broken glass or wind in dried grass. It's twist no more, like we did last summer. It makes you stop and think, makes you wonder, makes you less attractive, makes you a member of an ever-growing majority, a member of the silent majority. It reverts to simple tactics, to ancient ways. It shortens the pleasure principle and sings an endless song in rounds. It asks for the check before you've finished eating, asks for payment in full, asks you to accept its terms. It's a riddle, a conundrum, a mystery, a paradox, an enigma, a box within a box. It's the tunnel at the end of the light, a bridge as an abridgment, a bridge meant to shorten your span. The mutation of flesh into carrion, the dance of maggots, the wriggling of worms, the rotting detritus of what once walked through the door, sat down to meals, enjoyed the company of friends, went to the movies, dreamt about the future, had its pants taken out, its shoes repaired, saved love letters, wrote bad poetry, played racquetball at the health club, forgot its keys, drank alone late at night, and was moved by the tragedy of the human condition, of which it was forever and at once a part. Civic Center before an audience of senior citizens, and their behavior was disgraceful. She tells me how beautifully, how exquisitely Jesse Norman sang her program of German Lieder, her voice and her diction impeccable. But the audience, made up of so many old people who were hard of hearing, couldn't appreciate the subtlety of her performance. Almost everyone in the hall was shifting impatiently from one position to the next, whispering, coughing, yawning, falling asleep, and only coming to life, finally, when she revised her program to include some Negro spirituals. And then, at the end of the last number, during the applause, they all began to rush out of the auditorium, the customary mad stampede to the parking lot, to beat the crowd. But because the house lights hadn't been turned up yet, and the hall was still dark, there were a series of accidents. People fell in the aisles. Someone broke a hip. Another dislocated a shoulder. A wheelchair was overturned. And ambulances were called. Paramedics ran in with their medical kits and gurneys. These old people have such bad manners, she says. Such a lack of courtesy. And there's no question that Mom and Freddy are growing old, too. There are loose, sagging folds of skin under their chins. Freddy's arms, once strong and muscular, look like sticks now, is flesh hanging flabbily from them, while Mom's upper arms are soft and puffy. They've both been shrinking over the years, the progressive effects of long-term gravity. And they both walk stoop forward from the waist as if they're doing impressions of Groucho Marx. And now, when Freddy drives, he can barely see above the steering wheel. Actually, he spends most of his time looking through it. And he drives along, a few threads of hair left on his head whipping in the breeze, until Mom asks him to close the window because the wind is messing up her own thinning hair, which was just done at the beauty parlor, and through which you can clearly make out the outline of her skull. And coming forward to hug Freddy goodbye at the airport, I can't help noticing a branching blue vein in his nose, which seems to be the only part of him that's been growing over the years. Freddy is becoming deaf, but doesn't quite realize it. He talks very loud all the time and shouts into the telephone. Once I gave him a hearing exam. While he held his hand over one ear, I recited numbers. He couldn't hear a thing. He said, "All right, quit kidding around." And I didn't have the heart to tell him I'd actually been speaking. So I repeated the numbers, this time very loud, so he could hear and repeat them back to me. And Freddy has developed some peculiar habits over the years. When he brushes his teeth, he spits into the toilet. He says it gives the bowl a nice fresh odor. And he's always clearing his throat and spitting into toilets all day without flushing them to conserve water. So whenever you go to the bathroom, you see a murky wad of bubbly saliva floating on the surface of the water. And sometimes I see him sneak over to the liquor cabinet and take a shot of whiskey, holding the bottle up to his mouth, looking like an old drunk. Yes, he's becoming a character. And I wonder what he, as a young man, would have thought had he been able to look into the future and see himself as he is today. I look at the old photos of him in his early to mid-20s, at what appears to be a handsome, self-assured, fashionable young man staring with smoldering Rudolph Valentino eyes at the camera lens, as if he fully intends to master life, to grab fate by the throat, and bend it to his will. Years ago, when my parents lived on Long Island, one of Freddy's best friends was a man named Conrad. He was tall, dark, handsome, intelligent, charming, a touch arrogant, an excellent golfer, and an extremely successful businessman. He ran one of the largest supermarket chains in the country. He was the most envied person in my parents' circle. He lived in a white mansion on a beachfront estate with beautifully landscaped gardens, a swimming pool, a stable with horses, a beautiful, adoring wife and two children. His life seemed blessed. And then, slowly, this man whom my stepfather worshipped and for whom my mother might have suffered secret pangs of longing grew slightly forgetful and somewhat disorganized. He realized there was something wrong and went to a neurologist. Preliminary tests revealed nothing, but his condition gradually worsened. There was something clearly wrong with his short-term memory, with his ability to call on, process, and synthesize information. It was affecting his performance as president of the company. He went to another doctor for a brain scan. The results were disturbing. He'd suffered brain damage, the result of what seemed to be a minor stroke. He tried to continue working, but his mind failed him. He couldn't understand what was going on at meetings, didn't know half the time what his subordinates were talking about, and sometimes couldn't find his way back to his office. Finally, after a series of embarrassing and humiliating episodes, he took a leave of absence from the presidency, hoping he might eventually return to his post. But his condition only worsened. More tests suggested that a scuba diving accident 6 months before in which he'd gone down too far beneath the water and had blacked out, had caused a disruption of the flow of oxygen to his brain. In any case, he was now suffering from Pick's disease, which was progressive brain shrinkage. And soon, he began to forget people's names, couldn't recognize his friends, and even his wife and his children became strangers to him. He lost the power of speech, couldn't dress and undress himself, no less control his bodily functions, and was, at last, committed to an institution where a few years later he died, an idiot. On the surface, Freddy was philosophical about it. These things happen in life, he said. There's nothing you can do about it. He stopped visiting Conrad when Conrad failed to recognize him anymore. And Conrad was never mentioned in our house again. It was as if he'd never existed. Sometimes when Mom talks about herself or tells an anecdote or a story, she begins rubbing her thighs with the palms of her hands. It looks sensual, lewd, lustful, as if she's a woman in heat, a nymphomaniac dying for sex. I find it almost impossible to listen to her when she does it. One evening, Freddy interrupts one of her stories and says, "Do you see what you're doing?" He mimics her, and she looks surprised. He says, "You do it all the time." Then he asks if I've noticed it too. "Yes," I say, "I have." And I think that when Mom begins to unzip her clothes and undress in front of company, that you really should draw the line. She says she's not aware of it, that she has no idea why she does it. But she's obviously communicating something, I think. An erotic feeling of some kind that must be threatening to Freddy. Freddy says it's a form of masturbation. She's embarrassed, but doesn't know what to answer. Later, a man, a violinist with whom she plays duets on the piano, calls to arrange their next rehearsal. While she talks to him, she holds the phone in one hand and rubs her thigh with the other, up and down, up and down. Freddy looks at her, and I look at Freddy, noting the alarm in his face. One afternoon, we look through piles of old photos, many of which I've never seen. Pictures not only of my mother, but of my dead father and other relatives I've never met or barely remember. The photos of her as a young girl are especially moving, because I can see her before me as she is now, her life almost over, and the difference between then and now is heartbreaking. I look at the photos of her as a girl, at her dark eyes, her dark hair, her pretty face full of humor and mischief. My mother, who lived 60 years ago in Vienna and went to school and played with her friends on the cobbled streets of the city and dreamed of what her future might be. But what had she wished for herself? What had she hoped for? She certainly could never have imagined in her wildest fantasies what was to happen. An unhappy love affair with a young man, followed by a difficult marriage to a much older man, my father. She was 18, he was 42, when they married. The move to Germany, where he lived and ran his business. The rise of Hitler. The escalating fear and persecution of the period. The birth of a crippled son. The flight to America, to New York City. Her husband forced to begin a new business all over again in a foreign country, and dying a few years later in a car accident caused by a stroke. Then a second marriage to Freddy that began in romantic love and grew increasingly bitter and unhappy over the years. The move from New York City to the suburbs of Long Island, where she never felt comfortable with the people. The failure of the family business and the comfortable retirement in Florida, living on the money they'd received through German reparations after the war. There were certain experiences she remembered vividly. Her family's escape from Poland to Austria when she was a child of 3 or 4, running from the advancing Russian army. The stories of atrocities, of babies stuck on bayonets, of widespread rape that terrified the population, so that the roads were clogged with refugees fleeing the Russians, walking with knapsacks on their backs, and riding in wagons piled high with belongings next to the retreating Austrian soldiers. Her family, to avoid the crush of the main highway, took side roads. But a wagon wheel came loose in a riverbed, and they had to wait all night until a peasant farmer, at a certain price, was willing to help them fix it. And when they finally arrived in Vienna, the city was crowded with refugees, and their father frantically searched for an apartment. And she remembered how her mother had told her she'd wanted an abortion instead of giving birth to her. But now she was glad she'd had her, and how she didn't believe it, and felt unwanted and thought she had to justify her existence. And she told me how, before she married, she'd lied to my father about her early love affair, had claimed she was no longer a virgin, and had described in detail what her lover and she had done, and the places they'd done it, laughing now as she recalled it. "I don't know what I must have been thinking," she said. And then, the terror she felt on their wedding night, when she didn't know what to do, and how it took 3 nights for them to finally consummate their marriage. And she told me about Kristallnacht, when the Nazis smashed, looted, and burned all the Jewish shops, stores, and temples. And how that night at the railroad station she was frantic because she couldn't find me and the nurse. Didn't know that a porter had let us through and onto the train without tickets. And how she waited in the terminal and then took a cab back to the hotel, almost hysterical, because she didn't know what had happened to us. And then, finally, when the train was about to leave, she sensed we might already be on it, boarded it, and was so relieved when she saw us that she broke down uncontrollably, crying as she'd never cried before, her body racked by sobbing. And that was when she experienced her first nervous collapse. Sitting at the dinette table in the kitchen, her eyes water on the brink of crying, as she tells me her two favorite songs when she was a young woman. "The Wanderer" and "I Left as a Stranger," which she feels describe her life and express her true sense of herself as an outsider, always apart from others, never belonging anywhere, always wanting to be where she wasn't. And listening to her tell her stories about growing up in Vienna and what it was like living in Germany with my father and how the rise of Hitler had affected their lives and the flight to America. Hearing her tell about herself in the old days is like a religious experience for me. It's like listening to words of scripture, to a sacred text, to a spiritual poem. It's like a prayer. It's my foundation. It's where I came from, and I never tire of listening to it. Side, and the sound of the rain outside my window, and I think of the thunder as the voice of my father, which does not frighten me. It's the only way he knows how to speak. He'd speak softly, if he could. It's the closing of the book, the slamming of the door, the quenching of the flame. It is nothing. Tangible negativity. Immersion in emptiness. It has no color, no sound, no substance, no mass. It's the irredeemable coupon, the final handshake, the least welcome visitor, the cruelest joke of all. It can be fastidious or sloppy, prissy or a mess. It can sneak up on you or reserve its place in advance. It is forever a great consolation and a consolation prize. It's the last thing you'll ever do. It's a hollow laugh, like crow's feet over broken glass or wind in dried grass. It's twist no more, like we did last summer. It makes you stop and think, makes you wonder, makes you less attractive, makes you a member of an ever-growing majority, a member of the silent majority. It reverts to simple tactics, to ancient ways. It shortens the pleasure principle and sings an endless song in rounds. It asks for the check before you finished eating, asks for payment in full, asks you to accept its terms. It's a riddle, a conundrum, a mystery, a paradox, an enigma, a box within a box. It's the tunnel at the end of the light. A bridge as an abridgment. A bridge meant to shorten your span. The mutation of flesh into carrion. The dance of maggots. The wriggling of worms. The rotting detritus of what once walked through the door, sat down to meals, enjoyed the company of friends, went to the movies, dreamt about the future, had its pants taken out, its shoes repaired, saved love letters, wrote bad poetry, played racquetball at the health club, forgot its keys, drank alone late at night, and was moved by the tragedy of the human condition, of which it was forever and at once a part.
Freddy went into the hospital. I flew down to Florida.
My parents were both good-humored, upbeat, perhaps to keep their emotions under control. I felt as if we were three soldiers joking in the lull before a major battle. A shadow hung over everything. The day before Freddy was to enter the hospital, I tried to make a deal with God. I jogged to the tennis courts at the far end of the development, take the longest route around the back of the administration building, and return to the house by way of the front gate, easily a 4-mile run, further than I'd ever gone before, if God would let it not be cancer. If I didn't make it, then Freddy was in God's hands. It was 11 a.m., around 90 degrees, very humid, and the sun was moving higher in the sky. I ran to the tennis courts without any difficulty, but on my way back, I don't know how, somehow I made a wrong turn. And after a while, I realized I was in an unfamiliar part of the fountains. The sun rose higher and higher, and it was getting very hot. And I peeled off my t-shirt and wrung the sweat out of it before stuffing it like a wet rag under my waistband. Then I tried to find my way back, feeling increasing panic because I didn't know if I had the strength to continue running much longer, and because I didn't know where I was. And it was like being in a labyrinth. There were no familiar landmarks, just street after street of identical private homes and three-story apartment buildings shimmering in the heat. And the sun seemed to be forcing me down to the ground like a huge scalding hand, pressing down on my head, back, and shoulders. And the bottoms of my feet felt scorched by the hot pavement, and my legs felt as if they'd give out at any moment. I'd been running about 40 minutes now, and I was utterly lost, and exhausted, and dizzy, and nauseous, and realized that if I didn't stop soon, I'd probably faint dead away. And then both Freddy and I would end up in the hospital together, and Mom would have a nervous breakdown. So I stopped running, thinking that I'd killed Freddy. I walked slowly up the street trying to catch my breath, until I found an architect looking at a house plan spread out on the trunk of his car, and I asked him for my parents' street. He pointed up the road, said I should make a left at the stop sign, that I couldn't miss it. So I walked until a stop sign came into view. And then when I got to the spot where I'd made my wrong turn, I ran back from there. I told God I'd run the full distance after all, and then some, but admitted that I'd also stopped and taken a break. Still, I wanted the extra mileage I'd put in to be taken into account. But I knew I'd failed, and that Freddy was at God's mercy. So Freddy, Mom, and I drove to the hospital with a small suitcase with Freddy's comb, toothbrush, toothpaste, deodorant, electric shaver, talcum powder, robe, and slippers in it. And we found his private room, which was very pleasant. A bed, a night table, a landscape painting on the wall, a window overlooking a grassy hill with palm trees, and the highway in the distance. A television set was attached to the ceiling by the foot of the bed, and the bed had a crank you could turn to adjust its height. The nurses were cheerful and efficient. Freddy unpacked his bag, undressed, and changed into his hospital gown in the bathroom. Then he came out, sat in one of the chairs, and sighed. None of us knew what to expect. But I had a bad feeling, considering the earlier skin cancer and the trouble with his blood, that something terrible was about to happen. We knew if it was cancer, extensive surgery was likely, what the doctor called a radical, and that Freddy would never be the same again. His life would be changed forever. Freddy had never been seriously ill in all his 78 years, was proud of his body, and I knew, somehow, he wouldn't be able to take it if he came out of this seriously disabled. He'd feel so defeated. I didn't know how he would get through it. There was a fragility about him, an inner sensitivity that he didn't often show, but I knew was there. And I remembered a party we'd gone to during my last visit, when I was sitting next to him and we were facing away from each other, both talking to different people. And I felt an emotion for him well up in me, and I put my arm around his shoulder. And then he surprised me by placing his hand on my knee. And we kept right on talking with these other people. And for some reason, I was so moved for that simple gesture, that simple response to my gesture, that I wanted to be able to show him in some heroic, self-sacrificial way how deeply I cared for him. And now I'd run to save his life, and I'd gotten lost, and I'd quit on him. During that first day, the day before surgery, Freddy performed his usual information gathering routine. He put on his robe and slippers, marched out of the room, and made I don't know how many trips down the corridor to the nurse's desk to check out one thing or another. The operation of the TV set, the use of the intercom, who were the nurses assigned to his room. He knew a lot of the people because he'd worked at the hospital as a volunteer for years. The type and kinds of medication he'd be receiving, the time the surgery was scheduled, the dinner menu. Would he be receiving an enema? Would someone come in to shave his neck, shoulders, and upper arms that night or the next morning? And could he have a sleeping pill before going to bed? Finally, when one of the nurses came into the room to take his temperature and check his blood pressure, she laughed at what she called his more than 50 visits and warned him he was wearing out the linoleum in the corridor between his room and their desk. And I was relieved they were all so patient and good-humored with him. And Freddy checked the blood pressure reading and said, 160 over 80. That's good. That's supposed to be all right. We left him that night at the last possible moment, 30 minutes after visiting hours had ended, when a nurse told us we had to go, and we drove home. It was strange being in the house without him, imagining him back there in the hospital room wearing his gown, and wondering what, if anything, they were doing to him, and what he was thinking. We'd have to be up at 6 a.m. the next morning. The surgery was scheduled at 8. So I kissed Mom goodnight and went to my room. I undressed, took a shower, got into bed, flicked on the TV, and watched, of all things, a woman dying from cancer interviewed on public television. She talked about the use of heroin for terminally ill patients and said, "Why shouldn't I take whatever I can to help me through the pain?" I turned off the television, took 1.5 Valiums, flicked off the light, and lay on my back in the darkness, wondering what would happen if Freddy died. What would Mom do? Where would she go? Would she stay in Florida in the same house and continue playing golf and bridge and going to concerts? Another widow at the fountains? Or would she compete with the other single women for the few available men left? She'd spent her last 40 years with Freddy, for better or for worse. And being alone wouldn't be easy. And what would my responsibility be? How long could I stay in Florida with her? And how soon would I be able to resume my normal life? And would she move back to New York, where the few remaining living members of her generation of the family still lived? Or would she move near me, to a retirement home? And what would that be like? I had no idea. A few minutes before 6, Mom knocked at my door. I washed, dressed, we got in the car and arrived at Freddy's room at 6:45. He'd already received a shot of Demerol and was groggy. His speech was thick, as if he was drunk. There was a band-aid on his forehead. Mom asked him what had happened. He said he'd bumped his head in the shower. I could see a blood stain under the gauze. We sat with him silently, and I noticed a lot of crusty granules on his eyelids and wondered if he'd been crying. Then two orderlies came in, lifted him onto a gurney, covered him with a sheet, and rolled him out of the room and down the corridor. And lying under the sheet, he looked small, sad, fragile, and I had an ominous feeling as if this scene were preparing us for another. Mom kissed him at the door leading to the operating room. I didn't. I just reached out and touched his shoulder. And I said, "See you later." Then they rolled him through the swinging doors and down a hallway to the operating theater. And Mom and I walked to the room where you're supposed to wait, where the surgeon eventually comes to tell you what happened and what it all means. About an hour and a half later, Dr. Cohen entered the room. "Yes, the growth was a melanoma," he said, "a particularly virulent form of cancer. But the disease hadn't spread, as far as they could tell, and no surgery beyond removal of the cancer itself had been performed." He said the question of radiation or chemotherapy treatments would be determined later, after consultation with a cancer specialist. But he doubted either would be necessary. "You see," he said, "cancer in people Freddy's age spreads very slowly, and he's as likely to die of something else as cancer in the long run." We went back to Freddy's room, where he was sleeping, rubber tubing winding down from a bag of glucose on a metal stand attached to a vein in the back of his hand. We sat down beside the bed and watched him. When he woke up, he asked Mom, his speech still thick, how things had turned out. She said, "We'll talk later." It sounded so ominous that I gave her a withering look and shook my head. So she got up, bent over him and said, "Do you want to talk now?" And he said, "Yes." She said it was cancer and that he'd have to undergo treatments. I couldn't believe what I was hearing, rose quickly, bent over him from the other side of the bed and said, "Dr. Cohen said the cancer hasn't spread, so there's no need for extensive surgery, and there's a good chance you won't have to take radiation. I think things look pretty good. Dr. Cohen is optimistic." Freddy fell back to sleep, and Mom and I sat down. She gazed out the window, and I tried to read the morning paper. Every so often, I'd look at the blanket covering Freddy and watch it rise and fall to make sure he was still breathing. A few days later, he was home again. Here is some footage of him and Mom calling everyone in the family to report on his condition. As you can see, he's good-humored, direct. "Well, they say it's a cancer, but no treatments are necessary because, you know, with people my age, cancer travels slowly, if at all. They looked down my throat and there were no signs of cells anywhere." He sounds firm, upbeat, aware of the danger, still confident. But later in the evening, in this shot, you can see him holding his brow, complaining of a headache. I feel panic, but say nothing. And when we turned out the lights that night, I waited to hear her scream from the bedroom when she found him in a coma. And I imagined speaking eloquently at his funeral. Say. And I got up, put on my running shoes, and in the light of the street lamps, ran to the tennis courts and around the administration building, turning back at the front gate, running the full distance without stopping, to show God that I could do it, and praying for His mercy.
You've been listening to A Death in the Family, written, produced, and narrated by Joe Frank. This program was produced in 1997 for the Joe Frank series, Somewhere Out There. For more about Joe and his radio programs, go to joefrank.com and sign up to become a member to help support Joe's work. You'll have access to his full catalog of over 200 radio programs, including rare recordings not available elsewhere. Thank you.